Hi, thank you for being with me. I'm Regina with PrayerCommunicationWithGod.com, and I'm honored to have you with me today. Today we're going to continue our study in the days of creation. We've already covered day one and day two. And if you recall, on day two there was a separation of the waters above heaven and the waters below. God created the expanse of heaven, and in order to do that, there had to be a separation of the waters. Remember, we looked back at what the waters meant and how waters equal wisdom. And we learned that with wisdom, understanding is there. Jesus was there with God in the wisdom on the days of creation. Today, we're going into the third day of creation, which is found in Genesis chapter 1, verses 9 through 13. We're also going to look at the minor prophet Obadiah and see if we can see any similarities in his message with the things that we're seeing in today's world. So let's begin by looking at Genesis 1, verses 9 through 13. Then God said, "Let the waters below the heavens be gathered into one place. Let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the gathering of the waters he called the sea. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees on the earth bearing fruit after their kind, with seed in them." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed after their kind, and trees bearing fruit with seed in them after their kind. And God saw that it was good. There was evening and there was morning, a third day. It is here on the third day that we first see that God saw that it was good. Day one told us of the formlessness and void of the earth, and God's Spirit hovering over the waters. Day two, we saw the separation of the waters so that the expanse of heaven could be created. And here in day three, we see a gathering of the waters, a gathering of the wisdom, and dry land appearing. We see the creation of seed, of trees, of fruit, and the multiplication of such. And God said that it was good. He saw that it was good. So it is here on the third day of creation that we first see it was good. Now, I want us to turn over to the book of Obadiah, which is just a one-chapter book. He's a minor prophet, and it's believed that during the time of Jezebel, when she was having all the prophets killed off, that Obadiah hid about 100 prophets in two caves. It's taught in different places that Obadiah went as far as to mortgage his home in order to bring rationings, bring food and water to these prophets that were hidden. He was a man of God, and his name means servant of Yah, servant of God. So let's look at the message, his vision that he had for Edom. The vision of Obadiah. Thus says the Lord God concerning Edom. We have heard a report from the Lord, and an envoy has been sent among the nations, saying, "Arise, and let us go against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You are greatly despised. The arrogance of your heart has deceived you. You who live in the clefts of the rock, in the loftiness of your dwelling place, who say in your heart, 'Who will bring me down to earth?' Though you build high like the eagle, though you set your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. If thieves came to you, if robbers by night, oh, how you will be ruined! Would they not steal only until they had enough? If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave some gleanings? Oh, how Esau will be ransacked, and his hidden treasures searched out! All the men allied with you will send you forth to the border, and the men at peace with you will deceive you and overpower you. They who eat your bread will set an ambush for you. There is no understanding in him. Will I not, on that day, declares the Lord, destroy wise men from Edom and understanding from the mountain of Esau? Then your mighty men will be dismayed, O Teman, so that everyone may be cut off from the mountain of Esau by slaughter. Because of violence to your brother Jacob, you will be covered with shame, and you will be cut off forever. On the day that you stood aloof, on the day that strangers carried off his wealth, and foreigners entered his gate, and cast lots for Jerusalem, you too were as one of them. Do not gloat over your brother's day, this day of his misfortune, and do not rejoice over the sons of Judah in the day of their destruction. Yes, do not boast in the day of their distress. Do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their disaster. Yes, you do not gloat over their calamity in the day of their disaster. And do not loot their wealth in the day of their disaster. Do not stand at the fork of the road to cut down their fugitives, and do not imprison their survivors in the day of their disaster. For the day of the Lord draws near on all the nations. As you have done, it will be done to you. Your dealings will return on your own head, because just as you drank on my holy mountain, all the nations will drink continually. They will drink and swallow and become as if they had never existed. But on Mount Zion there will be those who escape, and it will be holy, and the house of Jacob will possess their possessions. Then the house of Jacob will be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame. But the house of Esau will be a stubble, and they will set them on fire and consume them, so that there will be no survivor of the house of Esau. For the Lord has spoken. Then those of the Negev will possess the mountain of Esau, and those of the Shephelah of the Philistine plain also possess the territory of Ephraim and the territory of Samaria. And Benjamin will possess Gilead, and the exiles of his host, the sons of Israel, who are among the Canaanites as far as Zarephath, and the exiles of Jerusalem, who are in Sepharad, will possess the cities of the Negev. The deliverers will ascend Mount Zion to judge the mountain of Esau, and the kingdom will be the Lord's. My friend, this is a huge warning that Obadiah is bringing to Edom, to the land of Esau. I ask you, what house are you of? Are you of the house of Edom? Are you of the house of Jacob? It matters. It matters. Is there arrogance in you that needs to be dealt with? Ask yourself, Lord, where am I? Am I in those that are going to be saved, preserved, honored? Or am I in those that's going to face destruction? It's easy for us to point out the flaws of someone else, to judge the things that they do in their life. It's easy. But we're instructed to use righteous judgment. And righteous judgment doesn't have us going to everyone else and saying, oh, but you need to do this, and oh, you need to do that. No, righteous judgment has us first taking a look at ourselves. What seed is inside of us? What fruit are we bearing? What's there? Now that we've heard the message that Obadiah brought to Edom, the warning, I want us to look back at the third day. Because as we've been looking at understanding, the whole message has been taking off the old self, putting on the new self, walking in wisdom and understanding, coming into wholeness, coming into completeness. And the third day for me represents that. And I hope I can show you that. I'm not going to look at every instance that the third day is found in Scripture, because it's found in a lot. The term third day, or the number three itself, is found in multiple scriptures. And I once did a word study on this. So now when I see three, or third day, or third, I'm reminded of redemption because of my study. Because in each location that I've looked at the number three, it's had a redeeming quality. So there's redemption in the third day. And let's go back to the beginning. We're going to look at a few verses. In Genesis 1, 9 through 13 that we just looked at, there was a gathering of the waters the third day. On the second day of creation, there was a separation. And immediately following, on the third day, there was a gathering. And it was good. In Genesis 22:4, which is the recount of the offering of Isaac, it's where Abraham is called to offer Isaac, his only son, as an offering to God. It was on the third day that Abraham raised his eyes and saw the place from a distance, the place that God showed him to go. He didn't even know where he was going when he left with Isaac. But it was on the third day that he raised his eyes and he saw that place. And as you recall, when they got to that place, Isaac said, "Daddy, where's the ram for the sacrifice?" And Abraham told Isaac, "God will provide." So Isaac willingly went with Abraham up the mountain to be sacrificed. But just as Abraham told Isaac, "God will provide," God did. There was that ram there in the bulrush caught. So Isaac didn't have to be the sacrifice. God provided. Abraham was obedient. Isaac was obedient. So he figured out what was going on. He was a smart young man. Genesis 31:22 tells us that it was on the third day that Laban was told that Jacob had fled, and he began his pursuit of Jacob. But God came to Laban in a dream and said to him, "Be careful that you do not speak to Jacob, either good or bad." God was protecting and redeeming Jacob as Laban was pursuing him. Genesis 34:25, on the third day, when they were in pain, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, each took a sword and came upon the city unawares and killed every male. This is the city of Shechem. And it was in Shechem that Dinah had been raped. And these brothers of hers, Simeon and Levi, were in so much pain because of what had happened to their sister that they took up the sword. And they came into the city without Simeon ever knowing they were there. And they killed every male in that city. Every one. In Hosea 6:2, we see, "He will revive us. After 2 days, He will raise us up on the third day, that we may live before Him." On the third day, going to raise us up so that we may live before Him. My friend, are you coming to the end of the second day and beginning the evening of the third day? Because remember, it's, and the evening and the morning were the third day. Are you coming here? Are you entering your time of redemption? Throughout Matthew and Luke, we learn of Jesus rising on the third day. He had prepared them. He told them, I'm going to have to face this suffering. I'm going to go. I'm going to be in the ground in death for 2 days. But on the third day, I will rise. And there are many, many other instances of third day in Scripture. The third day, as I said earlier, is a sign of redemption, a gathering, a coming into unity. Even you are created in parts of a third. You're created with body, mind, and spirit. Body, mind, and spirit. For too long, they've been separated. God's bringing us into a wholeness of body, mind, and spirit. We're entering that third day. We're wearing the new self. We're journeying into learning how to love ourselves so that we can love others. And as we walk in this journey, we find wholeness. We find the completeness that He's offering us. And we are finding healing of our body, minds, and souls. We're finding healing of our relationships, healing of our finances, healing of old wounds that we've carried with us for a lifetime. That even though we may have forgiven those who've hurt us, we have to forgive ourselves. We have to take off the garments of shame and guilt. Put on self-respect, self-love. And once we do that, then we can truly respect others. And we can truly love others. But it's not going to be until we start this journey of healing. We have to start it. My friend, I'm here to start it with you. My personal journey into this started about a year ago. I've seen so many changes, good changes. I am here to go through this journey with you, to help you along the way, to help you go into yourself and find the healing that you need. It's there. God's offering it. You just need to walk in it. You need to explore it. You need to ask for truth. Seek His wisdom. Seek His understanding. He provides for us mentors, people who help us see the wisdom, gain the understanding. It's a gathering of coming together. We're not meant to do it alone. We're meant to do it with someone. And I am here offering you my time, the knowledge and understanding that I've gained over this past year. I'm here to share it with you, to help you. Let your healing begin today. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for each one that is watching this video message today. I thank you for their lives. I thank you for the life that you are offering to them. It doesn't have to be a life filled with hurt and struggle. Yes, pain is inevitable. We have to experience some pain, but we don't have to remain stuck there, suffering. David said he walks through the valley of the shadow of death. Not that he stayed, not that he lingered, not that he visited. He walked through it. When he come to the other side of it, his cup was overflowing with joy, spilling over so that it touched the lives of others. Father, I ask you to bring us to that point of completion, to that point of wholeness, where our body, mind, and spirit are together in unity and not fighting against one another, not accusing each other, but bring us into unity. We must enter unity of self, body, mind, and spirit, so that we can have unity with others, so that we can stop condemning others, taking away their right to choose. We can just bring them a message of love and hope, promises that you make to us. We can offer them the wisdom and understanding that you've provided to us. Father, we can't make them apply it to their lives. That's where their free will comes in. They have to be willing to listen. They have to be willing to choose. And that's between you and them. That's out of our control, out of my control. Father, I ask you to guide their paths, light the way, allow them to experience the healing. Draw them in to this time of healing, this time of unification of body, mind, and soul, this time of wholeness. Bring to them the evening and the morning of the third day, the time of redemption. I thank you for the blessings that you've already provided. I thank you for the blessings that are yet to come as we walk in your wisdom and your understanding. I thank you for the joy and the peace that you've brought to me, and that you're bringing an offering to all of these who watch these videos. I thank you for the life that you've given us. I praise you and I honor you, and I thank you that you love me enough to honor me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.